Thank you. So my life God.
Hallelujah.
It's good to be back in the house. Glad to see everybody that's here today, and pray for those that still out, but we bind the devil and he's defeated. Battle is his, right?
Hallelujah.
Amen. So COVID is just another name of a sickness that's been defeated at the cross and by the blood of Jesus Christ. And we aren't moved by that.
Amen.
And I'll take up tithes and offerings if you would need an envelope. I want to remind you that today is stretch offering, and also remind you that since we went here last week, it was Mission Sunday, so
hallelujah.
Don't forget to support the missions that we, the church supports, if you have the money available and the Lord leads you, and stretch offering, everything that comes in on stretch offering goes into our new building, so praise God for that. Also, it's Memorial Day weekend, so take time to be thankful for the military, the men and women in the military who have given their lives for us, for our freedom, for those that are continuously serving. You know, we've lost some young people here recently that's in the military, so there's, you know, young families out there, so in your prayers, lift them up, and always, you know, just have a thankful heart. It's not about the beginning of summer, you know, even though it does start off the summer season, it's not about picnics, it's about being thankful and remembering the people who gave the biggest sacrifice for our freedoms. And so just remember that this weekend as you get to celebrate and have an extra day off.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I said that, really. Bible starts Wednesday, goes through Sunday morning. And kid, like I said, we'll have a nursery for 5 and under. So if you have to bring your children, because Raven falls in that. You know, most of our kids fall in above that, but we do. They can sit in here and they can bring their little tablets or something color draw with. But we want them to hear the word, you know, and get used to being in the out here in the congregation. You know, sometimes they can't sit as long, so don't think they're going to be a distraction. You know, don't worry about that. And if we get here and we see a need to extend the age, we'll take it by that. But we do have a worker schedule. To be back there.
I just wanted to thank everybody for your prayers and texts and thank your words. They meant a lot to me, and I did watch the service on Sunday, and I really do appreciate this church. This is our church family, and it's nice to know that those of you that had met Grandma, she hadn't been down here in many years. When we were in the basement of Pastor and Miss Yvette's house, that's where she came to church, and one time when her mommy had come in, and so she thought a lot about Pastor Rob, and she thought a lot about our church, and she said, I can feel the Spirit here, and so I know that Grandma is with Jesus, without a shadow of a doubt. Did not know I was going to do half the funeral, but it is what it is, but God gave me the strength to do it, and I just give him all the praise that I was able to pray with my grandmother. At 50 years, I got to have her in my life, and within those 50 years, I can't tell you how many prayers we prayed together, how often we spoke about the Lord, how much we loved Jesus, and how we knew where we were going to spend eternity. And that's a blessing. You know, it's a blessing to have a grandparent at my age anyways, but to be able to be a born-again believer and have my grandmother be a born-again believer. And I just ask that y'all keep my mama and my brother in your prayers. You know, I miss my grandma because it was my grandma, but she was someone who lived in their home, and her presence is missed. They know she wouldn't want to come back because she was ready to go. She told us on a regular basis. But I just thank God that he gives you the strength that you need to do the difficult things. I thank him that he meets our every need. Just God was with us all the way up there, and when we're driving to the cemetery, we're driving past the old home place which Grandma hated, so I didn't know why they drove past that, but anyway, I think it was more for everybody else than it was for her. She would have whizzed right on by, but I was riding with my cousin, and God gave me plenty of opportunities to love on him and to share Jesus with him. And I expect those seeds to be, they're planted, and I expect them to be watered, and I expect a harvest from them. But we're just talking and sharing, and really had a touching moment, and we're both crying, and it was just memories that we had. And then a bird hit our window, and we about jumped out of our skin, and we weren't expecting it at 55 miles an hour. And so, that woke us back up. But, it could have been worse, because he could have went right off the road, and there are no shoulders. You're right off the road. And I just thank God that he protected us with that. But I just encourage everyone, just get with your families, love on them, pray with them, make those memories. That a lot of what I saw out in the congregation at the funeral was a lot of regret. And there was a lot of folks that didn't come around, they didn't check on Grandma, they didn't call her, they didn't write her, and she had done so much for them and over the years. And what I saw, and it was something that my mother had brought up, and I thought, and I had been telling her, I said, well, Mom, the thing is eventually when she passes, it's going to be the regret. And that's what I saw. I saw a lot of regret. And I don't want anyone, when it's my day to be with Jesus, I want someone to look up from the stage and look down and see regret. Don't take up time with your family. Love them like Jesus loves you. Take away their sin, even though they don't deserve it. It doesn't matter what they might have said or done, or it doesn't matter if they're living like pleasing unto the Lord at this point. You got to love them like Jesus. Give them that word and love them like Jesus. And that's the one thing I can say about Grandma. And I said it at the funeral, and she said it to me, and I was joking with my cousin. I said, it would be nice if she just said it to me for once and not had to add the rest. But she always said this. When I would tell her I love you, she would say, I love you too, and I love all my children and all my grandchildren. And if there was no other comfort for those at the funeral, I feel like I was meant to share that with them so that they know, even if they weren't being loving as far as actions and deeds, she still loved them. And isn't that just like Jesus? No matter, he don't stop loving us.
That's the love of Christ. Continuously loving us, Even though we leave him sometimes, walk away, he's still waiting for us to come back.
Well, first of all, I just want to thank God for everything he has been entrusted us with. I know, Memorial Day, we're not working. And I know thank that people that died to give us freedom. I am American citizen. I have to earn it. Today is kind of sad for me too, because there's a lot of people that cross the border and dying to try to get here. And the reason why is because I know still, and here you feel the freedom. Even though it's a lot of stuff going on, and we're not 100% free, how it is. But again, you can have things and not worry about somebody trying to kill you for this stuff. But the most important thing for me is that he teach me on his word to detach myself from the things of the world. He told us to enjoy it, not to love it. And a lot of people love the stuff they had, and they don't want to get detached from it, and they get hurt. If something happened to their stuff, they'll die too. That's not my case. I know I feel bad too, because I can't go back and feel free over there on my own land. Right where I was born, if I go out there and leave, they'll kill me. So it's messed up to work hard for the stuff that I had over there. And that's the reason why I thank God, because I'm not alone with the things that I left over there. Man. Even though I can leave, if I take what I got here, that they got to trust me with and take them over there, I can leave like a king. But it's not the point. One of the things that I thank him that he teach me how not to love those things, just to enjoy it, because he entrusts me with, they not mine. That way, if someday I lose everything, so bad, he'll give me some more. If that's for his case. I'm getting out of debt of everything that I purchased and everything, so I can give more, because it's the motivation on my heart.
Thank you, Lord.
Because I love him and I love people, so the people will be blessed by his blessings to me.
Amen.
Thank you.
All
good testimony there, Sarah.
I'm just thankful because I finished with all A's at the end of the school year.
Amen. School year's over. What little bit there was, right? Kind of strange school year they just had, but praise God, it's over, and they're starting their summer, and parents are starting their summer with And anybody else? Raise up our tithes and offerings to the Lord this morning. Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to sow into your kingdom, Lord. I'm thankful for each and every person that's here, Lord. And I'm thankful for each and every person that's going to hear the message through YouTube today, Father. And Lord, I just ask you to take these funds and use them for your kingdom, Father. I ask you to bless each and every person that sows, each and every person whose heart is with this ministry, Lord, and whose heart is with you, Father. As Sarah said, it's not the things of this world, Father God, that matters, but it's you, Lord, and the things that you let us use to bring you glory, Father. And let us always be thankful to you and everything that we have, everything that we're going to receive, and every person, Father, that we come across. Let us be a light for your kingdom, Lord. For those that are hurting today, for those that are sick, Lord, we just lift them up to you, Father. We ask you to touch them this morning with a special anointing from the Holy Spirit, Lord. And Father, I pray for our military men and women that's laid down their life, Father, and their families this morning, Father. Lord, I ask you to minister to their hearts and give them a peace and a comfort, Father. And Lord, I just ask you to let honor be given where honor is due, Father, and that people will not look down on them. And Father, I thank you for the men and women that are currently serving also, Father. Lord, protection around them, protection around their families, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I got the memory of Jesus, hallelujah. He's alive and well, praise God. When you turn to Colossians chapter 2, Jesus is wonderful, amen. And there ain't nobody like Jesus unless you follow what he's taught, said, and did. Then you just like him, amen. You can be just like Jesus. And you say, how is Jesus? Well, he's the light of the world and he don't walk in darkness. So when me and you follow him, we don't have to walk in darkness. And any kind of darkness is sin. So if I choose to follow him, then I don't have to walk in the darkness. The darkness is there. It's available. If you want to walk in it, you can make a decision to walk in it. But if you will bind those thoughts that are coming to your mind and get rid of them, you don't have to walk in it. I'm constantly, you ain't never going to get to a place where the devil ain't battling you. I remember Shambach. He was doing a tent revival, and a guy came up, or either it was Dad Hagin, one of the two, come up and they asked him, said, will you pray for me that the devil will never bother me again as long as I live? He said, well, I'll pray for you to die then. Because as long as you're alive, the devil's going to come against you, because that's his job, is to come against you. But in Christ, me and you are more than a conqueror. I don't know about y'all, but I'm really enjoying this, the Wednesday night services in him, in Christ. I listened to the one from Wednesday again yesterday. I need a little jolt, praise God. I worked outside yesterday. My sinuses started stopping up. Well, praise God, all that's healed in Jesus. All he got to do is just, I said this morning to bed, I said, one touch from him will change everything. Hallelujah. And then, you know, we worked outside a little bit, just for about 3 hours, and I felt like I had been doing squats for an hour. My goodness, I got up this morning, I couldn't even hardly sit down on the throne room. Glory, if y'all have ever experienced that, bodybuilders, you bodybuilders in here. Hallelujah, I know we got several of them. Hallelujah. I've been building this body for 58 years. Glory. So we're all bodybuilders, so we just might build it the wrong way sometimes. But praise God, he shows mercy and grace, you know, because if the devil could, he'd be done killed you. Y'all get that? If the devil could, he'd be done killed you. But for some reason, God is protecting you and let you live another day. Yes. Hallelujah. Now, if you're his child, he's doing it because you obeyed him. If you're in sin, he's doing it because he's showing you mercy. Praise the Lord. Ain't it amazing how we get upset and mad at people because they're in sin? Jesus didn't get mad at me when I was in sin. Praise God. He loved me anyway. So no matter what you're doing today, he's still in love with you. Hallelujah. No matter if you get upset, he's still in love with you. Me and Beth, we started working yesterday, and I just had an agitating spirit got on me just immediately. You know? And she said, that ain't like Jesus or something. I don't know what she said. That's not Jesus. What'd you tell me? We ain't going to have that atmosphere around here today. So she went and got her music, started turning the music on to change the atmosphere. Well, I changed and jumped on her. Praise God. I said, girl, get that off for you. We ain't going to have that around here. Oh. But you have to be careful, man, when you're out there and you're tired and fatigued, man, that stuff can jump on you easy. And you'll take it out on whoever's closest to you. But if you would just learn to love them like Christ loved you and love yourself and take the sin away from yourself, then you treat other people right. Hallelujah. We got to learn to love. Love covers a multitude of sin, what the Bible says. Well, if me and you ain't walking in love, it ain't covering nothing. But if we walk in love, it'll cover it. Glory. What's love? I take their sin away. They don't deserve it. But I do it anyway because Jesus did me that way. That's what this is all about, is living that commandment out in me and mine in your life every day. That no matter what's going on, we're walking in love. Hallelujah. Do you know how you really know if you're faithful to God and doing what he tells you to do? Last Sunday, you just missed not being here. Man, I missed not being here last Sunday. I wanted to come. I started to tell everybody, man, well, I'm going to be there and you can come if you want to. You know, but I called Pastor Scales and I got wisdom from him, got wisdom from Yvette, got some wisdom from somebody else, I forgot, and a couple more people. And the Bible says there's wisdom in a multitude of counsel. You know, even after I talked to Pastor Scales, I said, I want to have church, though. And then Yvette said, well, I don't think we should. I said, okay, well, we got two against me, so I'm afraid God. But I felt in the Holy Ghost that we really should just, you know, just that's just wisdom. Praise God. Get people sick and everything, and you know, but I just believe no plague can come down my dwelling. Man, you got to start believing that, confessing that, and believing the word that no plague can come down our dwelling. And we do what we can to keep it from happening. Like this morning, I ordered some Lysol, so after church, we can just spray the chairs and stuff, and that kills everything. So that's what we'll do after church when it comes in. But there's nothing wrong with being wise. Amen. And that could be, that's not really for coronavirus. That could be for the flu, for strep throat, for anything going on. You know, the common cold. The Lysol kills it all. We need to be spraying it, you know, when the kids get through playing back there in the back, because a lot of them put stuff in their mouth and everything like that. We just need to spray the toys and stuff and let it set. And by the time we come next week, everything be dead. So we just need to walk in wisdom as the Lord leads us and guides us and directs us. That don't mean I'm in fear, because I believe that no plague come down my dwelling. I confess every day several times I'm a healed man and a healthy body. And I say that no accident shall befall me, and no plague come down my dwelling, according to Psalms chapter 91. And I just believe it. By his stripes I am already healed 2,000 years ago at the cross. And if something attacks my body, then I have to tell it, no, you can't attack this body. You're defeated already in Christ. And I just have to believe that. And then when we come to church, you know, I tell people, you got symptoms, stay home. You know, they got symptoms, stay home. Why? Because they need to get their faith working to where the symptoms have to leave. You don't need to come to church if you're thinking in your mind, man, I'll probably make somebody sick. No, you don't need to be thinking that. You don't need to be saying that. You need to be saying, by his stripes I'm healed, and do what the Lord tells you concerning that. And the Lord may tell you, you know, stay at home. One service, and he may tell you to do that. If he does, then he told you, not me. Praise God. But if you want to come, you just need to come, believe God, you protected, watched over, and you healed. If he tells you to wear your mask, wear your mask. If he tells you not to, don't. You just got to do what he says. Amen? But don't be caught up in the bondage of it and get in fear, because that's all the devil wants me and you to do, is walk in fear. Because he knows if we walk in fear, that we open up the door for him to come in and do what he wants to. Amen. So don't walk in fear. Walk in faith. Glory in faith is Jesus. Amen. Just enjoy yourself and every day and tell people about the Master. And that's how you follow Jesus, telling people about him. Telling people about his love, loving them. You don't even love Jesus if you ain't loving people. Man, praise God. Well, verse 16 here says, you know, we're still talking about leaders have a special love for the people under them. That's not just talking about pastors, and that's talking about the people that have crews under them, people that have employees under them. You know, you should have a special love for them people, because Solomon told us when the righteous are in charge, the people rejoice. So when people are under you, they ought to be rejoicing. Now, they may get upset if you tell them something, get on to them, and they've done something wrong. They may get upset at that moment. But the whole work experience should be they rejoice. Praise God. They rejoice because they got somebody over them who's going to ask the Lord how they should be treating them. And that means that you shouldn't be complaining and griping about your bosses, employees, managers. or anybody that in your workforce. Because if you're griping and complaining and gossiping, you're in sin too. That's the Bible. God said there's six things he hates. There's a seventh thing he detests. And that's sowing discord among the brethren. So I should put no thought in nobody's mind that would cause them to think different about somebody else. Amen. That's a brother or sister in Christ. The Bible says that if me and you are spiritual, we're supposed to go to them and we're supposed to help them to get out of that. And that means that we're really spiritual. Why? Because I want the same thing they're going through to happen to me. Hallelujah. We ain't supposed to be mean to people. We're supposed to be in love with people. Amen. Love them. Take their sin away. They don't deserve it. Like most people come to church here, y'all know what I teach on. You know, I've been teaching it for the same thing for years, really. 10, 15, 20 years. Be 20 years in October. Same thing, just a few little tweaks to it. You know how I feel about tithing. You know how I feel about going to church. I mean, that's my main two, you know, things right there. But the fact of the matter is, if you don't tithe, if you don't come to church faithful, I love you just as much as I love the ones that come faithful and tithe. Hello? You just don't get to share in the blessings of God like you would if you was faithful to him. Praise God. Now, people, I've heard people say, they tell Yvette, tell Pastor Robert, don't be mad at me. If I'm mad at you for that, I don't even know what the message is that we teach you. If I'm mad at you because you don't come to church, mad at you because you don't tithe, mad at you because, you know, this or that, I can't be mad at you. I can be frustrated at you like God gets frustrated with us when we don't obey him. But that don't take no love away from you. That's just like you got kids when they act crazy. You shouldn't change your love for them. It may cause you to be upset with them, frustrated with them, but you still love them the same way. Hallelujah. Somebody yesterday, you know, me and Yvette, we were sitting there, something on Facebook, Sabrina was there, and this guy, something, I ain't gonna tell it all, but you figure it out. Anyway, I just got mad, I said to myself, well, man, if he'd just obey God and repent and come back, and the Lord would take care of him. Hello. And then I started getting stuffy. I laid down in the bed, and about an hour after I was laying there, he said, well, you didn't have that same attitude when it was your kids. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. Amen. Change my heart. I was telling Yvette about it on the way to church, and I was just a squalling. Hello? Because we got to let him come in and love us, and then we got to love people the same way he loved us. And then we sang that song, The Goodness of God. I was back there messing with Golden, tapping him on the shoulder. But then we got to that part where it said, The Goodness of God. Man, I just started crying. Man, the goodness of God, he's awesome. Hey, there ain't nobody like him. He's in love with you. Hey, do y'all get that? That Jesus is so in love with you, he gave his life on the cross so that you could live and not die? That's how much he loves me and you. And he don't hold none of our sin against us. He took all of our sin away and don't hold none of that against us. The only thing that's held against us is when we don't believe what he did for us at the cross. There's only one thing in that last song we sang that wasn't really correct. When it says, when you look at the cross, you see the empty tomb. But no, you got to keep your eye on the cross. You can't forget about it. God sees the cross and the empty tomb. Because Paul came to a place that all he wanted to know was Jesus and the cross. And the Holy Ghost would have never let him say that if it wasn't for me and you. We got to stay focused on the cross, because that's where he left us. That's where he took all of our sin away. Man, that was right there. And people won't take the blood out of the gospel. No, that was the bloodiest part of the gospel there was, when they beat Jesus beyond recognition and you couldn't recognize him as a human, and he did that for me and you. And when I watched the Passion of the Christ, man, it breaks my heart to see him like that. The first time I watched it, I got so mad at them Roman soldiers, I wanted to kill them. Beat my Jesus like that. But then I had to realize, man, y'all know he loved him just as much as he loved me. I just didn't get to walk in it. They didn't, because they didn't turn to him. But at least one of them we know said, surely this must be the Son of God. So him going through that at least broke the hard heart of at least one of them. And he can break your family members' hard hearts. He can break your co-workers' hard hearts. He can break anybody's hard heart if me and you just believe him and walk in love towards them. And there's no defense against love. Y'all know the devil can't whoop you not one day in one circumstance if you walk in love. He cannot defeat love. Why? Love's already defeated him and made an open show of him publicly. The problem is not with the people that you face every day. The problem is with you. Hello? You upset with somebody this morning? You mad at somebody? Somebody at your work's got you irritated? Somebody in your family's got you irritated? Go look in the mirror and say, it's your fault. You're going to change, straighten up, and you're going to love them just like Jesus loved you. Amen. And then just leave there saying, I'm going to follow this word that I got. I told myself this morning, I'm going to love like Jesus. And then leave there doing that. And don't let nothing come in and get you off of that love. Hallelujah. And I'm so excited about Jesus and what he's about to do in this world. How about you? I'm saying, let revival come. Man, I'm ready, Jesus. I'm ready to see the lame walk, the deaf hear. I'm ready to see all that, Master. Hallelujah. And I hope y'all are ready for it. Praise God. In verse 16, it says, so why would you allow anyone to judge you because of what you eat or drink? See, the Bible done taught us that we're not supposed to be out there telling people what they can eat and drink. The Lord may deal with you that you're supposed to, you know, that he may give you a diet that you're supposed to go on because he knows what's going on in your body. But that ain't something I can get up here and preach and tell y'all. If the Lord told me tomorrow, all I want you to eat is cabbage and drink water, and you can have a Coke Zero one time every week, and you can have a peanut butter cup one time a month, and I started doing that and it changed my whole body, I can't get up here and preach to y'all and tell y'all that's the way you got to eat, because that's what he told me. Because in Romans it says, don't let people tell you how to eat. Don't let them come against your diet. See, a lot of people want to cause so much strife and stuff over people eating what they eat. You can't eat this. Well, I just want to tell you, my Bible says I can eat anything in moderation. Now, if I've used my life for years, the Lord may change my diet and tell me what to do because he wants to straighten that out. You just can't keep eating at Golden Corral all the time and think you're going to be fit. Hello? You can't keep eating that stuff and think you're going to be fit. That stuff is made fast. Ain't no telling what they put in it. Hello? The golden tomato and all that stuff. You can't be eating all that stuff, the green tomato, not the golden. That might be the restaurant I'm opening. You can't be eating that, the green tomato, all the time. You can't be eating at McDonald's all the time, Burger King, and all that and think you're going to be fit and healthy. Now, you can pray over that food and say, I sanctify this food by your word and by prayer, and eat in moderation, and you will be okay. But you can't go in there and eat four Big Macs and three large fries and a milkshake and two Cokes and think everything's all right. Come on, you got to eat in moderation in everything. That's what the Bible teaches. So we need to do what the Bible says in everything that's concerning. When it teaches us a doctrine, we need to live in accordance with it. It said, what you eat or drink, insist that you keep the feast, observe it, the new moon celebrations or the Sabbath. Man, we do not go by all that stuff that the Jews went by. We are Gentiles. We were grafted into the vine, but all that stuff was pre-Jesus, pre-cross. Jesus did it because the cross ain't happened yet, because he was a Jew. He had to follow everything. He went to church on Saturday like they did. We go to church on Sunday now, but I don't have to go do a Jewish Passover because they tell me I got to. No, I don't have to follow all that stuff. First of all, they're looking for Elijah to come. I'm looking for Jesus to come. Hello? So I don't have to do all that stuff. I don't have to go by what they go by. Why? That's their religion. That's their culture. Their training. Now, if a Jew gets born again and they want to keep doing that, they have to talk to the Lord about that, not me. But as far as a born-again Christian living in the new church era right now, I don't observe the days of celebration, the new moon celebration, and the feast of the Passover and all that stuff. Or the Sabbath. I don't. Jesus said he's the Lord of the Sabbath. So any day that you set aside, like if people had to work on Sunday, they had to set another day aside for the Sabbath, they'd have to talk to the Lord about that. Really, Sabbath means he just wants you resting. People really are just working themselves slap silly. I mean, their body is breaking down because they don't want to take a break. That's what the Sabbath was for, to take a break and to honor and worship Jesus. So our Sabbath in the New Testament is Sunday. It's the first day of the week. You know, that's taught in all through the New Testament. It's the first day of the week. Verse 17. We've got to realize, man, we've got to follow Jesus and do what he said. You know, we can't follow what the unbelievers say to do. We have to follow what Jesus said to do, and believers tell you to do that are following Jesus. All of these were but a prophetic shadow and the evidence of what would be fulfilled, for the body is now Christ. See, everything now is in Christ. Everything me and you do is through Christ. Everything me and you follow should be Christ. It should be the revelation of what comes through the Master, Jesus Christ. Jesus, what he taught, said, did Christ, the one that knows everything, that was sent from God. Everything me and you follow should come from him. We should walk in him. We should do what he says. We should follow his ordinances. And we should only do what the Master tells us to do. If it comes against his word, me and you don't need to be doing it. Well, that's what my grandmama told me. That's what my mama told me. That's what my daddy told me. And that's what my pastor told me at the other church. I don't care what they told you if it don't line up with the words of Jesus. It don't matter what they say. My mom used to tell me that cleanliness was next to godliness. I didn't mean the Bible nowhere. She was just trying to get me to clean my room. Hello? Now you need to be clean. Hello? Some of y'all, man, you can't even let nobody get in the car and ride with you. I got in with this person, our neighbor, one time. They had to move the stuff out of the way to get in there. I said, praise God. You know, now sometimes if I'm drinking a water bottle or something like that, I'll take those and throw them in the floor, and then eventually get in there. Why are you in? I try to clean it out before she gets in there. So she bought me a little trash bag, but they don't ever leave it where I can reach it now. Hello? I mean, it was funny. About a month ago, I went to Kroger and I called them when I got home. I said, there ain't no yellow onion in here. I can't find it nowhere. I looked under the seats. I looked everywhere. So I went back and got another one a couple of weeks later. I got my car cleaned. When was that? Friday. Got back and they had the yellow onion sitting on the seat. Either they got under there and got wedged or something in it. And I'm glad it was in the bag because it turned blue and black. Hallelujah. But I looked through that whole car. I should have said, Lord Jesus, where is that onion? He knows. But I wanted to be quick to tell them, hey, y'all forgot an onion. And that thing cost a dollar. I'll be back over there, you know. But we need to be thanking the Lord. And when something goes wrong, we need to ask him, what's the answer to this? Tell me what I need to do. Hallelujah. And he'll tell you if you just ask him. He'll tell you where that onion is. Or anything else you're missing. Hello? Anything. First thing we want to do is call for help. Why don't we call the Holy Ghost first? Say, Holy Ghost, I need some help. Hallelujah. All these things are but a prophetic shadow and the evidence of what would be fulfilled. For the body is now Christ. We are now living in the full revelation of who Jesus really is. He said, you can't even know the Father accurately unless you know him. A lot of people try to get to know God. You can't do it without knowing Jesus. Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God. So you got to get to know him. What is it? He's love. He's what he taught, said, and did. You just got to get to know him to be able to walk after him. Somebody do you wrong, you got to get to Jesus. Why? He said, love them. He said, love your enemies. Surely if he wants us to love our enemies, he wants us to love our family members. Come on now. He wants you to love your enemies. He wants you to be mad as fire at your wife and husband. No, he wants you to love them just as much as he loved you. He wants you to love your children just as much as he loves you. He didn't say you have to agree with what they do, but he said you got to love them if you're going to follow him. If you want him to reveal himself to you, you got to love them. Take the sin away. They don't deserve it, but you didn't either. That's what it's all about in Christ, is doing what his word says, what the Master tells you to do. Verse 18. Don't let anyone disqualify you from your prize. Don't let anybody disqualify you from your prize. Y'all know who your prize is? Jesus. Man, Jesus is our prize. We're going after him. We're in a race. Paul said he's in a race. He's going to obtain the prize. The prize is the Master, to be able to be with him for eternity. Don't let their pretending sincerity fool you as they deliberately lead you into their initiation of angel worship. Man, this stuff's going on now in our world where people are worshiping angels and stuff like that. They worshiping devils because an angel of God ain't going to let you worship them. They're going to tell you, no, you can't worship me. You got to worship the Master. They got things, you know, now going around the internet and stuff where preachers and stuff are saying that these angels come to them and they're taking them to the rings of Saturn. And they sitting on the rings of Saturn. Worshiping this and worshiping that. All that is devils. groups of people are getting together and they're calling it some kind of group worship, and angels are coming and taking them up into the air. No, that ain't angels, that's devils. Because that goes against the word. You know how you know when people are following devils? They get flaky. You talk to them and it's like talking to a fruitcake. Y'all ever talk to somebody, man, it's like talking to a fruitcake. Where did they get that from? Where are they getting all that stuff from? And they want to tell you the Bible says this, the Bible said that. I say, where at? Where it? Show me what you say in the Bible says. Yeah, she, the other day she told me something. I said, where's that at? I need chapter and verse. Where's that at? I don't know this like you do. I said, you should know it like I do by now. And then I gave her a chapter and verse. You've got to know where to go in here, especially if somebody works trying to. You can't say all the time, hold on a minute, I'll call you back later. I got to call pastor and find out. Man, you got a phone now. If you pick that up and go to Google, you can just about put it in. He'll tell you where it is in the Bible. If you know a few verses, I mean a few words in the verse, it'll lead you to it, but you got to know the right words. Man, I thought there's been some verses I've been quoting for years, and I think, man, this is what it says. I try to look it up, can't find it. And then get in there and find it, see, it's a little different than what I thought. That's why you need to always go to the Word to refresh yourself that you're not quoting the Bible wrong. Hallelujah. Deliberately leads you into their initiation of angel worship, for they took pleasure in pretending to be experts of something they know nothing about. That's when you get in trouble, when you get around people, they don't know nothing about what they're talking about. But they get people to follow them. Hello. That's like you need to know, you know, I'm sick with a virus, and I go down to the mechanic shop. I need to talk to a mechanic. I'm sick with a virus. I need to know what I need to do. All they will do is probably say, change your oil. Well, how do you do that? Praise God. You got to go to the right person when you need help. If you're having mental problems, you know, you don't go down to the pet store to find out what to take. No, go to a Christian psychiatrist and let them help you. I mean, if you're really suffering from mental problems, you need to go get some help. It might have been something you done when you was younger, and you need to take something, straighten out something in your brain until it gets right, and then the Lord will deliver you and take you off of it. Now, the Lord can touch you instantly and change it. It's the same thing with healing or anything. Just one touch from Him can change anything. But are you to the place in your life where you can believe for that? You say, well, I believe. Well, the belief is we see it happen. See, anything in this word we believe for, we should see it happen in our life if we're truly believing it. And it's going to be a fight every day, especially when you're trying to obtain something from God. You're going to be in a fight every day with the devil when you're trying to get something from God. He's going to come against you and fight you, but guess what? You've already won. You just got to know that. Their reasoning is meaningless, and their reasoning is meaningless and comes only from their own opinions. It don't come from nothing but their own opinions. What they think, how they think it should be. You know, people saying now we got people on other planets. How do you know that? Well, you don't believe there's more life out there? I said, I don't have no idea. I said, but I bet you Jesus knows. And He ain't told me, so I don't guess I need to know. So why you spend all this time worrying about it? I remember when they found out Pluto wasn't really a planet. Because they finally, the thing they sent out there finally got there after 30 or 40 years. It took that long for it to get there. It ain't a planet. I said, well, to me it is. That's why I was taught in school. So, you know, then they come back a few months later and said it is a planet. So they get guessing. But my question to you is this. What difference does it make if it's a planet, a bush, a tree? What does that got to do with me and you? It really don't. People just want to argue over stuff. They find something going on, they want to argue over it. Who cares? I don't think I'm ever going to Pluto until I believe here. Then I can fly by it. Hallelujah. I can fly through the whole universe. I'll let you know when we get to heaven if it's a planet or not. Look, if you want to know, because I'll know then. Because I'll know everything He knows. Amen? So that's what we need to believe, that Jesus, anything He knows, He'll tell us if we believe and ask Him. He'll show us things that are to come. Verse 19. This teaching here really is telling me you to stay away from these people. Stay away from these people, man, that are causing division in your life and causing you to think and worry about things that's in your mind. Man, don't let them put more. There's enough stuff I go through every day to listen to people like that. They want to talk about this or that, and they got nothing to do with Jesus. Hallelujah. Is anybody else getting hot in ears at me? It's a little stuffy, ain't it? Check to see what them things are on. Like it done kicked up to 80. 68? Well, that's a good 68. Must be getting a little hot in here. Darling, don't let them know it's cold in here. Hallelujah. Arlene called over and got a coat hanging on.
I know it.
That's like a vet before we go to bed. You turn the fan on? I said, not really. She said, well, I get a little stuffy. I said, oh, Lord. Okay. Then I have to cover up. I don't like wearing cover. I really just lay down on the bed. You know? She covered up, wrapped up. I said, why don't you take that cover off if you're hot? I had to sleep with cover on. Okay. Praise God. Now I do. Hallelujah. They refuse to take hold of the true source. Y'all know who the true source is, don't you? Jesus. They don't want to have nothing to do with him. They want to give you their opinion of what they think and lead you off astray. That's what they want to do. They don't want to come to you with Jesus. They want to come to you with their philosophy, what they think, what grandmama, grandpapa told them. You know, that's why Paul told Timothy. He said, don't be led astray. Don't be led off track. Don't be listening to all the old wives' tales. Can't be listening to what my grandmama and great-grandmama and all them said. You've been doing stuff just because they said it. It ain't in the Bible. No, you got to listen to what Jesus said. Listen to him. Don't matter what they said if it don't line up with Jesus. They may have some good revelation. As long as the revelation lines up with the Word, you can follow it. But if it don't, you can't. You can't follow stuff that Jesus, that he ain't the author of. Trying to come up with your own doctrine. But we receive directly from him. I receive directly from Jesus. How about you? So you need to believe this and say this in your life every day. You receive directly from Jesus. You receive directly from his word. And his life supplies vitality into every part of his body through the joining ligaments connected us all as one. Man, Jesus joins all of us together. It's his power, his source. You know, it supplies vitality into every part of his body. And if you're born again, guess what? You're part of his body. So he's supplying the power you need to live every single day. He has got to listen to him and do what he says. He is the divine head who guides his body and causes it to grow by the supernatural power of God. Me and you should be operating every day as the body of Christ in the supernatural power of God. That's why Jesus told us in Mark 16 that we should lay hands on the sick and they should recover. We should be able to cast out devils. We should take up any deadly thing and it shouldn't hurt us. Hello? We should be able to do all that. Why? Because of the mighty power of God that's working inside of me and you. We need to follow what Jesus said. Follow it every day. Do it. That needs to be every day we get up. Jesus, what you got to say to me today? What you want me to do today? I'll do what you say. I'll follow you. I'm not going to be follow the devil. I'm not going to be tricked by him today. I'm going to follow you and do what you say today. Because you came to give me life and give it to me more abundantly. And I want to walk in that abundant life today. So whatever you tell me to do today, I'm going to do it, Jesus. So you got to be that way with him. And then you got to say, all things I do are pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what Jesus said about the Father. He said everything he did was pleasing to the Father. He's telling me and you to live that same way. That everything I do is pleasing to the Master. And you got to be able to say that out of your mouth. Do you really believe that? I mean, in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, it said, if you say you're his, you should walk like him. So if you say you belong to Jesus, people are to see him in you. Why? Because you're walking like him. What does that mean, walking like him? The first thing is you're walking in love. By this shall they know that you are my disciples. When you love one another, take each other's sin away when you don't deserve it. That's how they know that you're my disciples. Hallelujah. That's how they know. Praise God. And if you want people to know you're a disciple of Jesus, love them. Don't get mad and upset and holler at them. Don't be hollering at people, y'all. Mad and got them upset because when you start hollering, devils start coming. That's one of the number one things that brings devils in, is people screaming, getting mad, screaming and hollering at each other. Devils come running to that. They love that chaos. So when you get to hollering, here they come. Hey, y'all, they hollering, let's go. They mad and hollering, and here they come. They're coming to you. They're going to come to mess your life up. Verse 20, they will come to mess you up. Praise God. It said, for you are included in the death of Christ and have died with him to the religious systems and powers of this world. Man, wouldn't it be amazing if the denominational churches would read this and believe it, that in the death of Christ I've been delivered from all these religious systems? Hello? Man, I don't pray to Mary, I pray to Jesus. I don't do no Rosemary, I repent. Hello? I don't drink, liquor when I take bread. People say Jesus drank wine. Well, prove it to me. But when you study out of a Nazarene, he couldn't drink nothing that was made of grapes or eat nothing that was made of grapes. So let's quit trying to satisfy our flesh and let's satisfy Jesus. Hello. Can't tell me, people have told me, oh, it's okay to drink and then find out they got DUIs. Well, what happened? Surely Jesus would have told you not to drink that one extra one. Hello? If you was really listening to him, why don't you just stick with Welch's? You ain't going to get drunk. I've told people that before and stuff, and they say, well, you judging me and you overweight. I say, well, I tell you what, a recent ain't never caused me to run over somebody and kill them. Hello? But I know Jim Beam, Hennessy, all that stuff. You get enough of that in, you'll run over somebody and kill them and don't even know you're done. I ain't never been so intoxicated with a recent milk away, I didn't know where I was at. Think about that. Pray God. Yeah, people today want to make excuses for everything. People want to say they can do this and do that. I say, tell me in the Bible where you can do that. Don't just come and tell me you can do it. Tell me in the Bible where you can do it. Hello. Because the Bible says those that are led by the Spirit of God, that is the children of God. A lot of people do something and they didn't ask the Holy Ghost one time if they could do that. I ask him before we go on vacation and where we go and can we go? Man, I don't want to just show up at Myrtle Beach and he didn't tell me to go and I go out in the ocean and here come old big white, tear my leg off because I didn't ask Jesus. That's why I want to know where I need to go. We was at Myrtle Beach? We was at that time. We was at that Myrtle Beach and me and that guy was sitting up there talking, man. We was about 60 foot from the shoreline. And man, I don't know what happened, but there was a bunch of our black brothers down there. And I mean, there were 200 or 300 of them. And all of a sudden, they started running out of the water. I'm like, my God, what is going on here, man? And I was talking to my black brother about crying. Man, we was talking to each other about Jesus. And we standing there, and everybody running out of the water. And all of a sudden, I looked up, and here comes about 4 or 5 sharks, just about 5 foot in front of us. I looked at him, I said, man, don't move. I said, Jesus has got us, don't move. And he was a shaking. I thought I was going to grab him. I just stood there, and they just swam right on by us. Well, what would happen if you didn't ask Jesus what to do, and you took off running? They might have got you before you got that 80 foot in that water, because they can swim fast. So before I go anywhere, I say, Jesus, can I go there? And if he lets us go, if I go to the ocean, which is very seldom now, I say, Lord, how far can I go out? Hello? I don't like going to them oceans, y'all, and they just put out a fresh batch of sand. My God, that's like a workout. I mean, you need some snowshoes to walk across that stuff as big as I am. And I'm pulling my foot out of there, sand's going everywhere. I said, what in the world are they putting 5 foot of sand out here for? My goodness, then you got to carry a cooler and everything down there. Lord, I need a break. I mean, by the time I got there, I passed out. I got nothing I could do. I don't even think I went swimming for a while. I was out. Lord, y'all cover me up. Don't let me get sunburned. I don't know why they put all that sand out there. I guess it'll keep the erosion down. Man, they should pack it with something. Because here I come, I'm going to pack it. But you got to ask him every time you do something. Many of us been on one cruise, been all the way that we boarded that thing. Lord, you know what's going to happen. You know what's going to happen. And then they said, you need to come out here and do the safety thing. I said, I ain't no sense in worrying about that. Ain't nothing going to happen. But you still got to go. They were talking about you got to learn how to do this and get in the power, the what do they call it thing, the safe, the rescue boats and all that. I don't need to know all that. Ain't nothing gonna happen to this boat. Praise God. Before I got on that plane, all the way up to walking on the tarmac, Lord Jesus, is this thing gonna stay in the air for 13 hours? My first trip was to Brazil. Is it gonna stay in the air, Lord? Okay, let's get on. I was waiting for him to say don't. Hallelujah. I said, Lord, I know this is probably a lot of nerves. I need you to push them down. Lord, help me. I should have took a little 30-minute trip before I went on a 13-hour one. Praise God. Don't jump it, but I just jumped right on in and made it. And then the next one, I went to Pakistan. Praise God. Hey, Jesus, he'll take care of you, let him. I remember when, what was his name, the Brazil guy? But we still support him. Yeah, Rick Bonfield. He came to our church and did a revival, and he said, he wanted to meet with us. He said, the Lord is going to take you to Brazil. I said, well, is there roads to get down there? He said, you a Christian? You scared to fly? I said, yes, sir. Hello. And I said, where the road? He said, well, you probably could drive down there, but it'd take you a long time. I said, well, pray, let's see if we can get the route. But he talked me into getting on that plane, and you know, the Lord has done great things. It's amazing how when you go to foreign countries and they're hungry for Jesus, and Jesus shows up. I seen all kind of just wild stuff over there. But the problem was, it made me so mad at the church over here. When I got back, I was mad at everybody over here for a year or two because nobody believed Jesus like they did. I mean, I laid hands on a kid that was, he was blind in both eyes since he was 17, and God healed him instantly right in front of me. I didn't even believe it when it first happened. And then his mama started hollering. I said, what did she say? Because I speak Brazilian Portuguese. And they were speaking. I said, what is she saying? She said, he healed my son. He healed my son. And then this boy in the back, he was 16. He started hollering something. I said, what's he saying? He said, if he can heal my brother, he can heal me. He was blind in one eye from birth. And God healed him. And then they brought this baby up. And it was about 6 months old. And it had his belly button was about 3 or 4 inches long, just red as a beet. It was infected. They wanted you to touch their kids over there. Like when Jesus preached, they wanted him to touch them all and bless them. Well, they wanted you to bless them, so they brought that baby up, and we prayed. I watched that belly button go down in front of everybody. But the amazing thing was, it ain't like over here. If that happened up here, y'all would probably go wild. They didn't even really. It was like second nature to them. And then we had a big tent that was made into a church, and the adult was in there, and women and men would come in fat, and they'd leave and lose 100 pounds. During the service, I said, Lord, I'm available. I'm available for that blessing. It never happened to me. I told Yvette last night, I said, man, I'll be so thankful when the Holy Ghost hits our church and the churches around America like he did over there. You go to church and leave 50 pounds lighter, 100 pounds lighter. Leave there with gold teeth in your mouth because your teeth have fell out or you got them pulled or whatever. And the Lord just restores. So you got to believe he can do stuff like that. I believe him. I believe he can do it. The Holy Ghost can do it. And I'm ready to see it happen. Where somebody dies at somebody's house and we have a church, and instead of calling the ambulance, they just put them in the car, bring them up here, and throw them in the floor. And say, they dead. And then the Lord uses us to raise them back up. That's what I'm looking for. Well, we got to be ready for that. Prayed up, sensitive to him for that to happen. All of us are ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ if you're born again. If you're not born again, you're going to be in shock. But seeing something like that may get you born again. Hallelujah. He uses the miracles to bring people to Christ. Glory to God. It's amazing me how many people Jesus healed. They wasn't even a Jew. Wasn't even following God. He healed them anyway. Why? So they would come and follow him. Praise God. That's why he healed those people when they was sitting by the pool, and the angel would stir it once a year, and the first one that got in would get healed. He did it because he loved them. He was trying to bring them to follow him instead of following what they was following. He wanted them to follow him. For you were included in the death of Christ and have died with him to the religious systems and powers of this world. Don't retreat back to your being bullied by the standards and opinions of religion. We need to realize when people come to us trying to put us back in bondage to the things of the Old Testament, we need to we need to realize they're bullying us in the spirit, telling you you got to live by the Ten Commandments. No, you don't. That's the Old Testament. That's for the Jews. You live by the two commandments, and when you live by the two commandments, you fulfill the ten. You ain't going to break none of them by following Jesus and loving people like he loved you. You're not going to break not one of the Ten Commandments if you do what Jesus says. But you can't follow them, because when you try to follow them, Paul said, we make Christ of no effect. In other words, the death and burial at the cross and the resurrection, you make it mean nothing. He don't want us living by the law, because if they could have lived by the law, he never would have had to come. But he had to come because they couldn't. But he came and brought us a way that we could. We could live by the law of love and live like him every day. Amen? And just be in love with people. Man, just you need to let the devil know. That person in your mind that the devil thinks you mad at, you need to let him know. I'm not mad at them. Man, I love Jesus. I ain't letting that bother me. I'm loving Jesus. And he going to love them through me. I may not like nothing they doing. He's going to love them through me. And I just have to get out of the way so he can do it. Praise God anyway. Verse 21, I think we might finish this morning. Hallelujah. It's getting close. For example, there's strict requirements. See, all this is talking about the same stuff. About when you follow religious things of people, it gets you in trouble. We got to learn to follow Jesus and be free in him. When you follow their religious requirements, when you follow their strict requirements, you can't associate with that person, or don't eat that, or you can't touch that. Hello? You can't touch that. I mean, you better not touch no shrimp. I'm going to touch about a dozen and eat them. You can't touch this, touch that. No, you can't touch no catfish. I'm going to eat them. Yeah, but they bottom dwellers. I said, well, they sanctify when I pray for them. And they taste good. Hello. So I'm going to eat it with thanksgiving. Sanctified by the word and by prayer. And believe God that it ain't going to hurt my body. Amen. Next verse. That's what I'm going to believe. Any people out there tell you right now, you can't touch this, can't touch that, you can't eat this, you can't eat that. Hello. You can't do this. Grace covers everything. No, grace don't cover nothing unless you repent. They teach you all kind of doctrine of devils, and ain't got nothing to do with Jesus and his doctrine. When it goes against his doctrine, it's wrong. They tell you, you ain't got to repent. You need to run from them people's in terror. Because if you do wrong, you got to repent. And then 1 John 1:9 said, you know, it tells us that if we confess our sins, he's faithful, just, and forgive us and cleanse from all unrighteousness. Then you got preachers out there saying that don't even belong in the Bible. That they need to take that out of the Bible. Man, the Bible says if you add to this or take away, you're in danger of your name being taken out of the book of life. Man, I'm so thankful for 1 John 1:9 because I've used it many times. After you get saved, that's what that verse is for. Not before you get saved. Praise God. These are the doctrines of men and corrupt customs that are worthless to help you spiritually. All this stuff that men come up with, it's worthless to help you spiritually. That ain't going to help you a bit. You got to go by the doctrine that Christ brought, the doctrine that he wants you to walk in, and that's how it's going to change you and make you live every day according to what his word has taught, what it said, and what it did. Don't follow these rituals they come up with. Like I say, if a Jew gets born again and they want to still follow the rituals, I'm not going to say nothing to them. That's their custom. But a Christian that gets born again, that was a Gentile, got born again, no, you ain't supposed to do that stuff. You're bringing these rituals upon you and you're putting a noose around your neck and you're trying to fulfill and love God by the old way of loving him. No, the old way was you follow the Ten Commandments. The new way is you follow the two commandments, and that's how you really love him. When you have his commandments and keep them, you really love him. If you don't, you don't. Well, praise God. Verse 23, last one. Hallelujah. Did you hear me? I told that girl, she straightens me out on everything, ain't W. Oh, yeah. She said something to me this morning. I said, you just catch everything, don't you? When I say it, you catch everything. It was something I said. She said, well, that something, I don't know. I said, this guy was in a Camaro, a convertible, and the roof was down. He was on his phone. I told her on the way here, I said, he's calling his girl or something, tell her I'm on my way. And she said, I said, the sunroof's down. So she said, I did. I don't remember it. I said, well, you know what I'm talking about? There wasn't no sunroof on that car. So you knew I was talking about the roof coming down. And then I said, girl, you catch me on everything. Don't you listen to every word I say. I said, praise God. You listen to every word I say. And I turned that into a confession. My wife listened to every word I say. And then I had to add, and does it. Amen. Hey, David said, I hear you. And then I said, and does it. And he looked back down at the Bible. He didn't even agree with me. Arlene, have him clean all the bathrooms this week. He got a good job.
I clean mine.
Hank got to work this week, and Rhea, they need you to come down and clean all this.
Please, thank you.
You just cleaned all of them.
I know. Verse 23, for though they may appear to possess the promise of wisdom in their submission to God through the deprivation of their physical bodies, it is actually nothing more than empty rules rooted in religious rituals. You know what that means? But some people in our life, y'all, they go to church, been in church a lot, you know, a lot, we've known a long time. Really, it ain't nothing but empty religious rituals that they're doing to make you think they're a Christian. And they don't know nothing about Jesus. Have y'all talked to people that go to church? They've been in church for years, but you start talking about Jesus, they don't know nothing about him. They know about David, Gideon, they know about Solomon, they know about Samson, they know about all them, and Goliath, but they don't know nothing about Jesus. And the real sad thing is you turn on TV and watch preachers, they don't even talk about Jesus. Mostly what they want to talk about is send the $100 in, get this anointed cloth, and take it back home, and God will pay your house off. What? If that's the case, I'd have bought 100 of them and put them everywhere. Come on, now y'all say some things don't even make sense. We used to support this preacher, you know, for years. He sent a thing in the mail. He said, if you'll send your tithes to us, he said, God, if you, and then he, on there, if you send your tithe to us, God will pay your house off. If you send $1,000, he's going to send you $10,000 back and so. I said, we ain't supporting that no more. But that was me. After a few years, the Lord said, I never told you to quit supporting him. He just made a mistake. Why didn't you just love on him? So we had to start supporting again. See, sometimes we make decisions, we got to go to him and ask him. We think they're wrong and in sin, and we should just cut them off. And the Lord said, man, I love them like I love you. Show some love. Any of y'all ever got off track? Said anything wrong? Done something wrong? We need to get... We need to quit being caught up in all this empty religious rituals that people try to get us caught up in because they trying to look good to God and to people. When the only way you're going to look good to God is to follow Jesus and do what he says. And then when you do that, people eventually catch on. Man, they following Jesus. They don't give in to this. Every time I do something wrong, they come back with Jesus on me. They tell me what he's saying. They tell me what the scripture says. That's my life. Y'all get a, if you get around me, you're going to hear the scripture. It may annoy you, but you're still going to hear them. Hello? You're going to hear me say, man, I love them just as much as Jesus loved me. I love them. Or Jesus loved them just as much as he loved me. They just don't get to walk in it as me and you do. Because when you believe in him, then you get to walk in it. Hallelujah. Well, all y'all didn't come today, we love you. And if you at the lake, be careful. Hallelujah. We love you. Have fun. Ask Jesus if you should go out there. Praise God. We pray, those y'all that said you had symptoms, we pray for you. The Lord will touch you this week and you get healed. Totally healed. Amen. We miss you. We miss you, Evan. We miss you, Loyal. We miss you, Michelle. And Michelle. We've got two Michelles now. And Shane. And Lucas. And Juanita, glory, hallelujah. Did I miss anybody? We miss you, Dusty, and Coco, and Marley. Did I miss anybody? Praise God, I hope they don't get offended. Hallelujah. Yeah, we miss you too, Robert, and Sunshine, and Hannah. Praise God. Miss a lot of y'all. Hallelujah. We love you, though. We hope to see y'all Wednesday night. Revival starts, and if you can't make it, we hope to see you next Sunday. Hallelujah. Well, we love y'all. Y'all have, well, any. Anybody need to give your whole life to Jesus? Praise God, to rededicate your life to Jesus? Or anybody got sickness or pain in your body? Or any, quit rolling them eyes, it's just a tic-tac. I mean, it's just a tic-tac. I mean, my goodness, she's only getting two, I'd probably get 10. Anybody, watch, no rolling the eyes, watch this. Look at that, I mean, just absolutely loves Pastor Robert. Mama said, give me one. Don't you know how to pay $2 for these things? Anybody need to get sickness or disease? Or anybody want to get filled with the Holy Ghost and evidence speaking in another language? Hallelujah, man. Jesus just wants you to just follow him totally. Give him your whole life. That's what he wants from all of us. Every day, just about when I get up, I say, Jesus, man, my whole life belongs to you. That's how you get saved by confessing him as your Lord. And believe in your heart God's raised him from the dead. Well, you stay in that by telling people that you see every day, man, I just want y'all to know Jesus is my Lord. I tell people at work, man, Jesus is my Lord. I just want you to know that. If you ask me for anything, I'm going to tell you what he said, not what I want to say. Hallelujah. And you got to give it all to him. And let him work out your life. Glory. Anybody? Praise the Lord. Well, we love y'all. Y'all have just a happy Memorial Day. And we'll see y'all, some of y'all Wednesday, some of y'all Thursday, some of y'all Friday, some of y'all Saturday, some of y'all Sunday.